But we've never had the ladies groups to come. And so we're delighted to tell you that we're going to have Saving Grace Ministries. They're out of Houston, and they'll be here next Sunday morning, and they'll be telling their stories. And so I want you to come and be supportive of them and just show Christ's love to them and support. And I'm glad to know that God can conquer anything in life if we just surrender to Him. So that's coming this Lord's Day. All right? And then this is not in the bulletin, but I can't think of a more appropriate time to encourage you and invite you to go with me to Israel. Next year, in April, a year from today, I'll be taking whoever wants to go to Israel with me. And do you have that little photo that Joyce sent you, Micah? Would you put that up on the screen? You know what we're looking at behind us there? The tomb of the Lord Jesus Christ, where He arose from the dead. And I'm going to tell you something. There's no greater joy than to see and be there where these actually happened. And so, I don't know why Joy's not smiling. I'm a little tired too. You're just like walking when you're up there. But anyway, it was just a blessing. And I know that there's the Catholics have a place that they've designated to be that tomb. But I really feel like God preserved this place to be the real place where He was resurrected. And I walked in there and I got to see the place where they had laid Him there. And it's just an amazing thing. So I would encourage you, anyone like to go with us? And the foyer, we have these nice big brochures that tells you all about it. It's a 10-day trip. And that's part of your flight there. What's neat, the fee that you pay covers everything. I mean, your flight, your tips, your motel, they put you in 5-star places. It's just really nice. And I'm going to tell you something. People are worried, well, is it safe in Israel? It's safe as it is in America. You just go to any shopping mall and wonder if you're going to come out alive, okay? I'm telling you what, we live in a terrible spot here where we live. And we felt safe the whole time we were there. We didn't have any problem. And I tell you what, so if you're interested and want to go, please look at that and call me, let me know, and we'll get you all registered, ready to go with us. It'll be an exciting trip, and you'll gain so much from it. And everybody I've ever known who went to the Holy Land always wanted to go back. Barbara Nixon, is that true?
That is true.
That is true. She's had that privilege of going. And I know that there's been others that are not here today that have been there too. And I said, why do you want to go back? Why do you want to go back? And she says, you really can't take it all in. There's so much to learn, and it's such a joy to go to those places like that. So you need to start praying. Say, God, would you let me do it? I'm going to tell you what, I wish I wouldn't have waited so late in life. I think I could have been a better preacher, better teacher. I've had more insight. And now that when I read the Bible, I visualize these places. I say, oh, yeah, I know where that is. I know what's going on. So let me encourage you to consider that 10-day tour to Israel. It'll be an experience of your lifetime. And it's actually April the 2nd through the 11th, 2024. Okay? Well, having said that, I'm ready to worship the Lord on this Resurrection Day. We have several that are so excited about the Resurrection. They want to sing. And so they're going to be coming and singing, and Mike is going to be reading scriptures in between to tie it all together. So just enjoy celebrating our risen Lord today.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. As you stood in the crowd that day, watching Jesus die, you had heard him utter seven astounding statements, remarkable words, not only due to his duress, but because of the deep meaning they conveyed. The first is recorded in Luke 23:34. Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do. To whom was he speaking? Well, in reality, to all of us. Peter explained weeks later that all the house of Israel had crucified Christ. He then told everyone in the temple that they had killed the Prince of Life in Acts 3. Paul expanded the list in Romans to every human being with Romans 3:23. To us today, because of sin in our lives, we too have been enemies of God. He never turned cold-hearted towards us, just as Jesus' words here demonstrate so powerfully. So what can we do? Can we do anything less than to strive to love our enemies, to bless those who curse us, to do good to those who hate us, and pray for those who spitefully use us and persecute us, as recorded in Matthew 5:44. That's our duty because of what he's done for us. Melanie.
Y'all pray for me as I try to sing. If you'd been there, I'm going to sing an acapella.
If you had been there when they crucified Jesus, if you had seen the blood dripping down, if you
only sought mercy. He instantly responded.
Yes.
Compassion.
Yes.
Assurance. This is God's mind. This is God's love. God stands ready to respond to the repentant.
John,
the disciple Jesus had a special bond with, recorded the third of the seven last sayings, the words of Jesus to his mother Mary and John. Mary had seen more than her share of sorrow in the life with Jesus. Now, seeing her grown son hated by people and forsaken by friends, she stood by the cross of Jesus. No doubt Simeon's words to her when Jesus was a baby returned to mind. This child is destined for the fall and rising of many in Israel. Yet here was Jesus, intensely suffering, but thinking of the needs of his mother who had loved him, and making sure that she'd be cared for by John. While much of the story of his last hours highlights his relationship with the Father, this reveals the honor he felt for his human mother when he said, "Woman, behold your son," and turned to John and said, "Behold your mother."
I brought him cause to cry.
Amen.
The Gospel of Matthew and Mark both record the fourth of the seven last sayings. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? What did he mean by forsaken? In Psalms 37, David once wrote, I have not seen the righteous forsaken. Forsake means to abandon or leave helpless. Being forsaken is a horrific experience, but to be forsaken by God would be the worst. And surely the Father hadn't forsaken him. Later statements show Jesus knew his Father didn't, but did momentarily leave him helpless. Why? Well, first, Jesus was taking on himself all the sins of humanity, fulfilling the prophecy written in Isaiah 53:6, the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. And God would not intervene to ease anything associated with the penalty of sin. Sin causes suffering, and Christ bore its full weight, including the emotional trauma of comprehending how sin distances us from God. He had previously declared, the Father has not left me alone in John 8. He had never experienced the aloneness that comes with being cut off from God, but now, bearing the sins of the world, he did. Have you ever felt alone, forsaken? Christ knows that feeling, and he can give us insight and understanding and faith to use to get through such times. Daniel.
They all walked away with nothing to say. They just lost their dearest friend. And all that he said, and now he was dead. So this was the way it would end. The dreams they had dreamed were not what they seemed. Now that he was dead and gone, the garden, the jail, the hammer, the nail, how could a night be so long? Then came the morning, night turned into day. The angel, the star, the kings from afar, the wedding, the water, the wine. And now it was done, they'd taken her son, wasted before his time. She knew it was true, she watched him die too. She heard them call him just a man. But deep in her heart, she knew from the start, somehow her son would live again. shadows vanished before the sun. Death had lost and life had won, for morning had come. Death had lost and life had won, for morning had come.
The Gospel of John records the fifth of the last seven statements of Jesus. I thirst. Knowing that all things were now accomplished, that the scripture might be fulfilled, Jesus said, I thirst. In his anguish and all the agony, he still remained clear-headed and aware that the prophecy of Psalm 69:21 needed to be fulfilled. For my thirst, they gave you vinegar to drink. This again demonstrates the physical suffering, and he therefore understands our hurting too. But thirsting, even more importantly, is also a spiritual matter. Christ told the Samaritan woman, whoever drinks of this water will thirst again. But whoever drinks of the water that I shall give him will never thirst. But the water that I shall give him will become in him a fountain of water springing up into everlasting life. He walked in our shoes. We need to walk in his and discover what he knew. In Matthew 5:6, it says, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled.
Joy he gives.
your throne this morning, Father. We just want to lift you up and thank you so much for the sacrifice that you made. Dear Father, it should have been me on the cross. We don't deserve what you've given us. And your Father, I just pray and ask you now to bless this service in a special way. I know, dear Father, in a crowd this big, there's somebody here that doesn't know you as Lord and Savior. And dear Father, it's my prayer that before this day is over, they'll get that settled. It's because of this resurrection that's what our belief is based on. And dear Father, I just love you and thank you. Dear Father, I ask you now to bless this offering, multiply it to meet the needs of your church. And dear Father, continue to be with the remainder of the service. Be with Brother David as he brings a message. Just give him boldness to speak, give him strength, give him everything he needs to share the message that you put on his heart. And dear Father, just continue to keep your hand of guidance and direction on our church. We're living in some perilous times right now. We really don't know what tomorrow may bring, but dear Father, you do. And dear Father, we're just leaning on you. We're leaning on your strength. We're leaning on your guidance to help us through. And dear Father, just all we can do is just praise you and thank you for all you do. And dear Father, just continue to forgive us what we've done. For it's in the blessed, sweet name of Jesus I pray. With thanksgiving. Amen.
We'll see how this goes.
John records six of the seven last sayings of Jesus. It is finished. What did he finish? Much. That day saw at least 25 messianic prophecies fulfilled, witnessing to the inspiration of God's word. At age 12, Christ had said, "I must be about my Father's business," in Luke 2. And now that work committed him, it was finished. He was only minutes away from concluding his ultimate work of the flesh, offering himself as our atoning sacrifice. His beaten body and shed blood paid for our sins. He never wavered from his destiny. The Lamb of God, slain from the foundations of the world. Now he had triumphed. Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him, endured the cross, despising the shame. Also finished with Satan's fate. It was through Jesus' death that he might destroy him who had the power of death, that is, the devil. That's Hebrews 2. Satan remains to be cast into the bottomless pit, but his time is coming. The Day of Atonement, one of God's holy days, explains how God will shut the door on Satan and open the door for humanity to reconciliation with him. What has God given us to finish? Can we be as dedicated as the one who endured to the end to complete his work for us? Luke records the last of the seven sayings of Jesus. Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. He who freely gave himself into the hands of his executioners was now committing himself into the hands of his Father. In life, he had always submitted to his Father's will, and now in death it would be no different. The forsaken feeling he had experienced shortly before no longer remained. He knew God would answer his expectations, so gasping his last breath, Jesus uttered his last words, words of complete faith. Father, into your hands I commit my spirit.
Oh, Lord.
much for me. Oh Lord, my Redeemer, all my love I give to Thee. I cannot forget His face as I stumbled from that place with the questions and burning, put myself to learning. Answer came with grace, and I knelt in His prayer. His memory is still there, and the more that I inquire, the higher burned the fire. I found joy beyond compare. The day turned into 3. Morning found me in a garden where the gentle April breeze brought me to my knees, praying for a pardon. And I can't say when or why. But His feet were there before me, His hands were opened o'er me, and His face I recognized. Oh Lord, my Redeemer, Thou hast done so much for me.
Amen.
God just filled my heart, and I know you do too. We need to give a standing ovation to every one of you who came and sang with us. I tell you what.